Okay, so then why don't we do that? Okay? All right, so at this time, I will call this meeting to order. Clerk of the Board, would you please call the roll?
Certainly, Chair. Commissioner Baker?
Here.
Commissioner Garrettson? Commissioner Granados?
Here.
Commissioner Kowalski?
Here.
Commissioner Leone?
Here.
Commissioner Mirabella?
Present.
Commissioner Palmieri Mudet?
Here.
Vice Chair Hudak?
Present.
And Chair Williams?
Here.
Chair, you have 9 commissioners present for the regular meeting.
Thank you. Would you please lead us in the prayer and salute to the flag?
Humbly we ask God, the giver of peace and lover of charity, to give the entire family of nations true agreement with his will, and to grant the light of his spirit on all who work for justice and peace. Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay. Clerk, would you please read the Statement of Compliance with the Open Public Meetings Act?
The Chair wishes to announce that pursuant to the requirements of the New Jersey Statutes Annotated Title 10, Chapter 4, Section 10 of the Open Public Meetings Act, adequate notice of this meeting of the Board of County Commissioners of the County of Union has been given by mailing the annual meeting schedule for the year 2022, along with periodic changes necessitated by circumstance, to the newspapers circulating within the County of Union who are designated to receive such notice, and by posting the annual meeting schedule for the year 2022 in the Administration Building, and further, by filing the annual meeting schedule for the year 2022 with the Office of the County Clerk.
What was that last part? I'm sorry, the last sentence?
I'm sorry.
All right. May I have a motion?
I filed the annual meeting schedule for the year 2022 with the Office of the County Clerk.
Thanks so much. May I have a motion to approve communications?
So moved, Madam Chair.
Second.
Okay, moved by Commissioner Mirabella, seconded by Commissioner Leone. Would you please call the roll?
Commissioner Baker?
Yes.
I'm kind of lost. What are we doing now?
I'm sorry, this is the approval of the communications.
Oh. Aye.
Got it, thank you. Commissioner Garrettson?
Yes.
Commissioner Granados?
Aye.
Commissioner Kowalski?
Yes.
Commissioner Leone?
Aye.
Commissioner Mirabella?
Aye.
Commissioner Palmieri Mudet?
Aye.
Vice Chair Hudak?
Aye.
And Chair Williams?
Aye.
Chair, you have 9 votes in the affirmative on the communications.
Thanks so much. Tonight we have an ordinance for introduction. Clerk of the Board, would you please read the ordinance by title?
Certainly. Ordinance number 836-2022, an ordinance to amend the laws of Union County, administrative code and policies, and general legislation by adopting the 2022 Department of Parks and Recreation fees for recreation facilities and Union County Office of Health Management food and beverage fee schedule.
Okay, thank you. I would like to ask Vice Chair and Policy Committee Chair Hudak to please move this ordinance on first reading.
Thank you, Chair. I move ordinance number 836-2022 for first reading and authorize the Clerk of the Board to advertise same in accordance with the law. The public hearing will be scheduled to be held on March 3rd, 2022.
Okay. I'll second that, Chair.
Okay. Well, you know who moved it. Seconded by Commissioner Kowalski. Would you please provide us with a roll call?
Certainly. Commissioner Baker?
Aye.
Commissioner Garrettson?
Yes.
Commissioner Granados?
Aye.
Commissioner Kowalski?
Yes.
Commissioner Leone?
Aye.
Commissioner Mirabella?
Aye.
Commissioner Palmieri Mudet?
Aye.
Vice Chair Hudak?
Aye.
And Chair Williams?
Aye.
Chair, you have 9 votes in the affirmative on the ordinance number 836-2022.
Thanks so much. This meeting is now open to the public for the purpose of commenting on resolutions being offered for adoption and or on any governmental issue that a member of the public feels may be of concern. Kindly state your name and town of residence for the record, and if speaking on a resolution that is on this agenda, please note the resolution number to which you're referring, and please adhere to the 5-minute time limit. Thank you.
Yeah. Hi. John Burry of Kenilworth. And I have a general question at the end, but to start off, there are five things on resolutions, comments, and three comments, two questions that are Bruce Patterson's, and I'm reading for him because he wants to use his 5 minutes on another topic. I know what it is, but I don't want to spoil the surprise. So starting off, 163, the first three are comments. 163, T&M is getting $420,000 for construction, administration, and inspection of Plainfield intersections. This is an abusive number, no shovel in the ground. 164, Neglia is getting $209,000 for the same work, same type work as above, but for many miles of county roads. Half the cost for more work doesn't make sense. 166, MAST is getting $70,000 more for a total contract of $2.5 million for the county stairwell project. The total project cost is north of $25 million. It's a black hole. Now, the two questions. 181, the Officer of Inspector General demands repayment of $861,000 in home grants. Can you explain this? I mean, he says this needs explanation, capitalized. 191, lawsuit, Reynolds versus Attorney General. We are now spending $40,000. We need an overview of what is happening here. And then my question is about the fence between Nomahegan and Blackbrook Park. It just appeared in the last few months. Both sides, it's a wooden post fencing, and it's down an incline. I mean, it doesn't seem to have a purpose unless you're going to run cattle. Nobody's done that for 150 years. So, and it doesn't look like it's anything to do with flood control. And it's 1 mile, I mean, both sides. So the question is, why that was done? What was the purpose? Who did it? You know, how much did it cost? And is that it? Is there going to be anything more? Like when you get to the end, right before you go to the boulevard, there you might want to extend that so you go right to the trap and ski place. Is that going to be done, or anything else, or are we finished with that? Oh, okay, that's it. Thanks.
Thank you so much. Let's see. For Resolution 181, the grant reduction repayment, Deputy County Manager.
Certainly, through you, Chair. About 6 years ago this month, the Office of the Inspector General launched an audit of our Home Investment Partnership Program. Originally, they requested us to return $6 million. We have been working for the last 6 years to reduce that amount. We believe that this will settle everything up, so I think we've done quite well. These are all projects that are from a number of years ago, I'm happy to say predated me. And we just have tightened up some of the way that we do things to make sure it never happens again. And I feel like we have done quite well working through the audit to end up with a number like this. And the HUD was gracious enough to allow us to do a voluntary grant reduction, so we just forfeit funds that we would have had to actually pay back. We can just voluntarily take them back, but we get to keep them essentially because we can just reprogram them. So it ends up that we'll be able to reutilize them for something else anyway in the affordable housing arena, but this is the way it works. So the reason that this resolution is on is just really it's a housekeeping measure just so that we have it memorialized why those accounts that were associated with this were closed out, and then we'll reprogram those funds once this is done.
Thank you so much, Director Wagner. And number 199, the additional appropriation, County Council, can you just address that?
Yes, thank you, Chair. This litigation arises out of a former employee in the prosecutor's office. Unfortunately, we believe the suit has no merit, so we are vigorously defending this, and that costs money. Our attorney is fighting, and it is a difficult litigation, so it has taken additional funds to continue to fight. I would note that we are attempting to obtain reimbursement, at least for part of these funds, from the State Attorney General's office, and that is an ongoing process as well. Thank you, Chair. I think that answers the question.
Thank you so much. And then Director Zuber, Director Graziano, the question about the fence in Namahegan.
Sure. That's part of the Lenape Park Rehabilitation Dam project that we're doing. The fence that's down below was requested by the previous county engineer, so people stay out of that part of the dam underneath the flat area. And there is some older fence in that area that will get replaced. We're working on one side of the dam now. That's why that fence is there on the one side Mr. Berry commented on. Then the other side, hopefully eventually we'll get everything else replaced that's there.
Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Okay, are there any other members of the public coming forward?
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen of the Commissioner Board and Dr. Garrison. This is Bruce Patterson, Garwood, New Jersey. Sadly, Chair Williams, our honeymoon is over. And to Commissioner Baker, when I refer to commissioners collectively, I leave you out since you're brand new. Some grand plan, well, let us refer to the timeline and extraordinary costs that reflected the complete disaster that Finance Chair Bibby Taylor has personally created through the illegal bidding process of the Union County government complex. Some grand plans started in 2019 by you and the commissioners through resolutions to start a silent takeover of the Union County Improvement Authority. Then by action of County Manager Oatman in mid-2020, and despite our county bylaws stating employees with full-time jobs cannot hold other jobs, he appoints Finance Chair Bibby Taylor as head of the UCIA, violating the county bylaws. She makes an additional $60,000 annually, plus her $170,000 county job for this double dipping. By the end of 2020, UCIA head Bibby Taylor summarily fires all the UCIA employees. This was known by the commissioners and should have been the first red flag of what could be occurring. Now, with complete control of the UCIA in 2020, with no accountability or oversight, she starts enacting County Manager Oatman's plans for building a Union County government complex. 2020, the illegal bid process starts. The first warning of this illegality was at the end of 2020 when the state comptroller sent a letter pointing out many possible issues found in the bidding, which Bibby Taylor and possibly her mouthpiece lawyer Minchello dismissed. The illegal bid process continued. Near the end of the illegal bid process in early 2021, one of the general contractors, Dobco, sued, noting the bid process skirted local public contracts law. In court, the judge allowed the bid in phase one to continue, warning that a recent precedent had been set regarding the skirting of contracts law and subsequent stoppage of a project in Bergen County. And this project is very similar. Bibby Taylor and lawyer Minchello ignored the judicial red flag and quickly started giving out contracts and spending money. In late 2020 to mid-2021, I, with my 40 years construction experience in bidding, design, build, and plan inspect projects, pointed out many times to the commissioners that Bibby Taylor's bidding process is improper and the project must be halted, that the court case is proving such. The commissioners ignored experience views. While Bibby Taylor quickly spent $11 million up front, the court case came to a head and a panel of judges put a stop to the construction. The bidding process was deemed illegal, violating public contracts law and not in the interest of the public and transparency. This disaster created by Bibby Taylor with the help of County Manager Oatman, plus their legal mouthpiece Minchello, and even the complicities of the commissioners now draw a huge cost. By the professionals involved in the project, these costs are enumerated in the court suit and the total blame falls on the apparent incompetent and arrogant Bibby Taylor, who thought she could act with no accountability and transparency. Mass Construction claims it will cost another $10 million in professional fees. Lurch Vinci Higgins states it will cost another $20 million in excess lease cost. All this falls on Bibby Taylor's shoulders. Knowing how contractors front load schedules of values and invoices, and her complete ignorance and misunderstandings of construction, the taxpayers lost another $2 to $3 million through phase one. Demolition of a small building, minor remediation, and bridging documents do not cost $11 million. The commissioner should reach out to the attorney general for an investigation. This falls on Bibby Taylor's shoulders. With this total disaster of the bid build project processed, all from her alleged ignorance, inexperience, misfeasance, and incompetence from Bibby Taylor, this will now cost the taxpayers at least another $30 million. The final joke on us is that she doesn't even live in the county to feel the impact of this disaster she created. We demand accountability in this fiasco. Bibby Taylor is ground zero and must be summarily fired for this. County Manager Oatman, who is well aware of the impending disaster and was involved in the creation of this disaster, must be held accountable also. Legal mouthpiece Mincello, who ran cover and gave extremely poor legal advice, must be summarily dismissed from all workings with the county and its entities. His integrity is in question. We apparently find that Bibby Taylor cannot be trusted. Bibby Taylor must be fired from the county.
Okay, Mr. Patterson, your time is up. Thank you for your comments.
I was done anyway. Thank you very much.
Okay. With regard to a number of those comments, there is pending litigation, so we cannot comment, but I would call upon County Council to say a little something.
Thank you, Chair. As the Chair said, I cannot make specific comments on the legal issues, but I will dispute Mr. Patterson's opinion that there was an illegal bid process used in this matter. It is correct that subsequently, after the process was done, that the courts of New Jersey essentially changed the law. But at the time that this process began and the bidding started, there were a number of courts, trial courts, including the assignment judge here in Union County, who had in prior cases ruled that this process was legal and correct. And so Union County proceeded based on the law as it was at the time we went through this process. It is correct that subsequently the appellate division has reversed that. The decision that Mr. Patterson referred to, which was somewhat misreported in the Star Ledger, came out earlier this week. I can let the board and the public know that the New Jersey Supreme Court has taken up a further appeal of that decision by the appellate division at the request of Union County and our utilities authority. Obviously, we don't know what the ultimate outcome is going to be, but I would most strenuously disagree that there was any illegal bid process in this project. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you. You know, I would also agree that it's premature to be casting aspersions on someone's character when this is all still being litigated. So that is not appreciated. Are there any other members of the public who want to make comments? Okay. So seeing no one else, I will formally close this portion of the meeting and ask for a motion to adopt Resolutions 2022-146 through 2022-203.
So moved, Madam Chair.
Second.
Okay. Moved by Commissioner Mirabella, seconded by Commissioner Palmieri Mouded. Would you please call the roll, Clerk?
Certainly, Chair. Commissioner Baker.
Aye.
Commissioner Garrettson.
Yes.
Commissioner Granados.
Aye.
Commissioner Kowalski.
Yes.
Commissioner Leone.
Aye.
Commissioner Mirabella.
Aye.
Commissioner Palmieri Mouded.
Aye.
Vice Chair Hudak.
Aye.
And Chair Williams.
Aye.
Chair, you have 9 votes in the affirmative on all resolutions.
Thank you. Now we come to commissioner reports. I will start to my far left. Commissioner Dr. Gerritsen.
Sure. Thank you so much. As tonight we are having the last meeting during Black History Month, there have been a number of activities that we can all be so proud of. But again, Black History is not just one month. It's every day, every year, the struggle. I just want to acknowledge what happened in one of our neighboring counties. It may not be our home, but in Somerset County, what I saw is innocent until proven guilty. However, what we saw was horrific. And we really need to make sure that we stand together with our colleagues in Somerset County, because what was recorded on was horrible to witness. I would be remiss if I did not acknowledge that. There are so many positive things that do continue to happen, so we should stand strong, but also recognize that everything in the world, the things that people do, are not always what they should be. So I'm hoping and I'm hopeful that we will continue to make sure that we follow the truth and we are not misguided by mistruth. Those are my comments tonight.
Thank you, Dr. Gerritsen. Thank you, Dr. Gerritsen. Commissioner Leon.
Good evening, everyone. I just want to share some information. I would like to inform our residents of the updated schedules for COVID-19 testing and vaccinations throughout our county. The testing for the COVID-19 PCR saliva and rapid nasal testing in the Plainfield Performing Arts Center will take place Tuesday through Friday, 2 to 6 p.m., and Saturdays from 9 to 1 p.m. The COVID-19 nasal testing at Kane University in Union Township will take place on Mondays, 7 to 12, and Thursdays, 7 to 12, and 3 p.m. to 7 p.m. Kane will be open for testing on President's Day on Monday, February 21st. COVID-19 testing at the Jerry B. Green Building in Plainfield saliva tests will continue on Wednesdays from 11 to 1 p.m. Vaccinations beginning Monday, February 21st, COVID-19 vaccinations will be available according to the following schedule. Warren Anko Ice Skating Center in Roselle, Tuesdays and Thursdays, 3 to 7, Pfizer only, ages 5 and up. And also Pfizer boosters will be available. Kane University in Union Township, Fridays, 5 to 7 p.m., Moderna, J&J, and Pfizer, ages 12 and up. No pediatric Pfizer boosters are available at this time. Appointments for vaccines and testing can be booked online, and people must create an account at ucnj.org/COVID-19. And residents looking to visit the immunization clinic for a free COVID-19 vaccine can just walk in Monday through Friday from 8:30 a.m. to 4 p.m. Union County's Public Safety Department will once again begin working directly with municipalities to pivot back to mobile testing and vaccination, providing residents with as many opportunities as possible to test when needed, as well as get their COVID-19 shots. You can find all this information on our website at www.ucnj.org. Thank you. Those are my comments this evening.
Thank you, Commissioner Leon. Commissioner Granados.
Thank you very much, Chair. Just want to make mention of joining alongside Deputy County Manager Wagner, County Manager Oatman, and Director Moran, along with Sheriff Carvelli. Early this month, we had a joint law enforcement recruiting session, which definitely had over 200 people registered for it, and brought together Union County Police, Union County Sheriff's, Elizabeth Police Department, NJ Transit, and Port Authority Police, helping individuals who are trying to gain access and gain some more information on those law enforcement agencies, the help they needed to be able to apply. And now on February 28th, the county looks forward to partnering alongside Union County Prosecutor's Office and King University with another recruitment fair that's going to be held from 11 a.m. to 4 p.m. at Liberty Hall Academic Center. And it's going to bring together 24 federal, state, county, and municipal law enforcement agencies to participate. If any individuals looking for more information on becoming a member of the law enforcement or helping out fill out your application, definitely advise you to attend, because there's going to be great information there. Thank you very much, Chair.
You're welcome. Commissioner Palmieri Mouded.
Thank you, Chair. Good evening, everyone. On behalf of the commissioners, I would like to thank our residents throughout Union County who donated diapers and other essentials to the Moms Helping Moms Foundation drive that we did on MLK Service Day in January. This is the second year that we did this as an alternative to doing a hands-on service project. And we had drop boxes in Elizabeth, Garwood, Springfield, Summit, and Westfield. And we collected over 15,000 items, which included 9,100 diapers, 13,000 wipes, 1,600 feminine products. It was really fantastic, far exceeded any of our expectations, and is truly needed. One in three families experience diaper need. And I know it may not sound like a necessity, you know, if you're not thinking about it, but that means that a child does not have a diaper to wear. They cannot go to daycare if they can't provide the diapers to the daycare. So it's such an important thing that we were doing, and I'm so proud of everyone who participated. We had fantastic participation throughout the county, and I just wanted to acknowledge that and thank everyone who did donate. And that is all.
Thank you, Commissioner. Commissioner Kowalski.
Thank you, Chair. Some of you may have read in the media already, but I will officially say that I'm happy to report that funding has been restored to complete a study on flood control options for the Rahway River. This study is an essential first step in developing an effective plan to safeguard our communities here in Union County and in the surrounding area, and specifically Cranford, Springfield, Union, and Rahway, and several towns in Essex County have been very involved in recent efforts. You may recall that the study had received federal aid back in 2015, but a few years later, the funding was cut off before it was completed. And so now, on behalf of the board, I'd like to thank Senator Cory Booker, Senator Bob Menendez, and Representative Tom Malinowski, and also Congressman Don Payne Jr. for working diligently to restore the funding. Together with the Rahway River Mayor's Council, we will keep working on this project. It started probably 20 years ago, and we are not gonna stop until we get it done. So if we will get this the study finished and then work on getting a flood project completed. So we're looking forward to working with the Mayor's Council and the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers, as well as the New Jersey DEP in the months ahead. And I'd also like to just mention that Commissioner Palmieri Mudin and I had the pleasure of attending the first class of the Fire Academy over at our facility in Linden. And I just want to commend the new recruits. We look forward to seeing them join the fire departments, and thank Director Tomich and Dean Rule for letting us see the class and tour the facility. And that's it for me, Chair. Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner. Commissioner Baker.
No comment this evening, Madam Chair.
Okay, thank you, sir. Commissioner Mirabella.
Yes, thank you, Madam Chair. Just a couple of quick things for me. I want to commend the deputy county manager for stepping into the county manager's shoes tonight and being up here. Nice job. Amy, for your work. I know the county manager doesn't miss many meetings. I don't know that he's missed any recently, but it's great for you to jump in and fill in. It's a good teamwork that you have with the county manager. I am excited for tomorrow night to go to the Union County Performing Arts Center to see our Black History Month presentation of Fences. So that's going to be fun. And also where we get the opportunity to distribute the Chester Holmes Humanitarian Award. And I know many of us up here knew Chester. I had the great fortune of running with him for three terms, and we sat together for many, many years. And he was such an advocate for the people of Union County, and I'm overjoyed that this award continues in his name. He was a wonderful public servant from Rahway, represented Union County on such a great, great way, and I'll be very proud to be there and see that award handed out. And last but not least, Madam Chair, I do want to announce the nuptials of two of our employees. Armando Sanchez and Dina Mazaros got married this morning. So that's wonderful for them. Great couple. I wish them many years of happiness and health. And they were married by Berkeley Heights Mayor Angie Devaney. So it was quite of a county celebration. So wonderful for Armando and Dina. I wish them the best. And with that, I'll conclude my comments. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you, Commissioner. Vice Chair Hudak.
Thank you, Chair. An update on the county's plan to add a key parcel of open space at the Passaic River Parkway. That is a county-owned preserved greenway that runs along the Passaic River through Berkeley Heights, New Providence, and Summit. Last year, we entered into an agreement to purchase a vacant property at 735-737 Springfield Ave in Berkeley Heights, formerly occupied by a catering venue and parking lot. And we passed a resolution at our last meeting to finalize that sale. The property is adjacent to the Passaic River on one side and is bordered by the parkway on two other sides. This is yet another step in our efforts to carry out the vision of an interconnected series of greenways that link public parks throughout Union County. I'd like to thank Mayor Devaney, so two mentions to the good mayor this evening, for assisting in the effort to create more open space for use by all Union County residents and visitors. As called for by our agreement with the property owner, demolition work began last month, so we're looking forward to seeing next steps in restoring that property. And you know, partnered with the $4 million grant that we're receiving for the Clark Reservoir, for the acquisition and improvement of additional open space in Union County, which remains in the most densely populated state in the Union. So thank you, Chair.
You're very welcome. I just have a couple of things. A couple of announcements. Union County Department of Parks and Recreation is looking for lifeguards for our upcoming 2022 summer season at the Ulrich Pool located in Rahway River Park. Pay starts at $14.50 an hour with an opportunity to earn more as a returning lifeguard. Applicants must be 16 years or older, American Red Cross certified, which we will train, and we will train them if the requirements are met, and they must pass the swim and skills tests. The pool season begins Memorial Day weekend and ends on Labor Day. Weekends and holidays are mandatory for lifeguards, and then from Memorial Day weekend to June 12th will be about 20 hours per week on Saturdays and Sundays. From June 18th to Labor Day, it will be approximately 35 to 40 hours. And if you know someone who is interested in applying, or if you want to apply, please call or text the Union County Department of Parks and Recreation at 908-868-2725 with your name, address, and other contact information. As Commissioner Mirabella noted, the Chester Holmes Humanitarian Award and our Black History Month celebration with the play Fences is tomorrow evening, and I was fortunate enough to get a sneak peek at the sets, and they look spectacular. So it's going to be a really fabulous evening. And also, Cultural and Heritage Affairs has put together a virtual presentation by Professor Keith Wolcott of Union County College titled African American Survival from Jim Crow to Civil Rights and Beyond. That will take place via Zoom on Thursday, this coming Thursday, February 24th. At 6:30 p.m. And again, that's via Zoom. I hope to see you all at those events. And that's all I have in terms of announcements. So let's see, our next meeting for the public will be Thursday, March 3rd. And with that, may I have a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Second.
Moved by Commissioner Mirabella, seconded by Commissioner Kowalski. All in favor?
Aye.
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 We are adjourned. Thank you.